Hi, I'm Ankita Bhatkhande, a master's student of Media and Cultural Studies at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, India. This is my paper presented virtually for the 4th Asian Conference on Cultural Studies to be held in Osaka, Japan. The partition of India ranks beyond any doubt as one of the most tragic events of human history. The event that remains isolated as a historic upheaval is much more than its physical and demographic understanding. Cinema in India has dealt with the issue of partition through several narratives. Most films deal with the trajectories of violence on women, wherein they are imagined as repositories of national or communal identities. Women's bodies are seen as sites on which ideological and communal conflicts were staged. More often than not, the violence against women of the other community has been the central theme of movies such as Pinjar, Khamosh Pani and Train to Pakistan. While depictions of gendered violence during the partition find a key place in representations of female characters, there seems to be very little scope in order to depict their agency. The portrayals of women as victims somewhat subordinate seeing them as agents and thus continues the dominant narrative of partition violence and trauma. This paper attempts to look at three such instances of agency in Indian films, namely Khamosh Pani, Train to Pakistan and Pinjar. The rationale behind choosing these three films is that they all have female protagonists and secondly, their stories revolve around the lives of these three women post-partition of India and Pakistan. It is an attempt, therefore, to delve deeper into understanding of the historic event through the cinematic medium. So the methodology for the study involves qualitative methods like textual analysis, content analysis and a few interviews. There are two key variables that are used in the study, namely first one is partition films. So by partition films I mean feature films that deal with the 1947 India-Pakistan partition in their central or subordinate narratives. This particular study looks at three such films, namely Pinjar, Khamosh Pani and Train to Pakistan. Second is female agency. By female agency, I mean women's ability to negotiate with their private spaces, that is their homes and families, and also with their larger community spaces, like villages, religion, state, and society at large. The concept of female agency itself has to be understood in detail before moving any further. In her essay, Community, State, and Gender, on women's agency during partition, Urvashi Bhutalia, a scholar, says that there is much more to women during the time than violence and trauma. Through historical records, Bhutalia writes as to how in tough and adverse times during partition as well, women stood up for themselves during and after the time. According to scholars, it's difficult to arrive at a general conclusion about women, partition history and their agential capacity. Women have often played out multiple and overlapping identities. An understanding of agency also needs to take into account the notions of the moral order, which is sought to be preserved when women act, as well as the mediation of the family, the community, class and religion that these women are a part of. The accounts of women's heroism do not have to be hidden. They can be talked about. So while looking at female characters in these three films, the paper looks at the relationships of the women with her husband, her children, the state, the religion and then the larger community. Agency does not necessarily mean only an ability to assert one's opinion. For women, agency also means negotiating with the trauma and the ability to find spaces even within those conditions. Especially in case of partition narratives, a woman's socio-political agency is difficult to define. Although political agency in its conventional sense means possession of one's rights, it is far more complex in partition narratives. The very violence and migration without a woman's own will by her abductors or family members confiscates her political agency and robs her off from it. But when she moves to a new homeland, she still continues to fight for her voice to be heard by the society. She tries to mingle with the communities around her. She negotiates her rights as a citizen in a newly found homeland. And this is the way in which she shows her agential capacities, although in a very subtle manner. The narratives of trauma and violence during and after partition have been effectively addressed through films and documentaries on partition in India. In all the three films that are selected for the research, the female victim is the key protagonist. Protection of women's chastity and the trauma that it leads to in order to do so is a common narrative of these three films. While these films portray violence as a result of intercommunity violence, there are some instances that broaden the idea of violence itself against women. Large-spread violence within a woman's own community and house was a tragedy that women faced during the time. This meant throwing her in the well even before she was robbed of chastity, keeping her within the confines of the four walls of the house, and things like these. The impact of the cataclysmic event like partition on women was much more dramatic and enduring than that of men. This is because women were the soft targets of widespread killings. In addition to this, the post-partition era is also a story of rape, abductions, suicides, and widowhoods. The woman of the time is seen as a symbol of pride, chastity, honor of the family, even at the cost of her jumping in the well, her being killed by her own father, and her being raped. She was raped and abducted and abused by her own men in the refugee camps. Veero in Khamosh Pani is one such young sick girl who tries to escape the wrath of her family when they are about to push her in the family well. Abducted women had no say and they were later brought back to their original land. Indian and Pakistani authorities used the term recovery operation, thus showing to what extent they were objectified. Veero in Khamosh Pani and Puro in Pinjar are both such examples of abducted women from their homelands who get married to their own abductors. As these women are taken to their new homelands, they have to blur their past and live the rest of their lives there. Their families do not accept them anymore. So from changing their religion to loving the man who abducted them, they negotiate with all that comes and live a life of content in these new homelands. The post-partition era was a period of grief and turmoil. Those who moved from one place to another travelled on foot or in dead trains that never arrived. Those who wished to stay were disowned on religious grounds. People lost their identity, their relationships, their friendships, and were judged merely on being a Hindu, Sikh, or a Muslim. People had no access to sufficient food, clothing, and shelter. Even the richest went as refugees, and survival and existence itself was at stake even in spite of independent India. Puro from Pinjar is a Hindu woman who is abducted by a Muslim man, and so is Veero from Khamosh Pani as said. She is abducted by a Muslim man and taken to the village of Charki in Pakistan, where she spends her entire life searching for a long-lost identity. This dilemma comes to the fore when her son disowns her for being a Sikh in the influx of Islamic fundamentalism. Khamosh Pani is a film that underlines the celebration of masculinity, in a sense, by highlighting the religious fundamentalism in Pakistan during Zia-ul-Haq's regime. The language of honor and protection is being deployed by Rashid and Salim, two characters in the film. Both function in the service of patriarchal ends and not the needs of the women. The characters of Salim's friends, Rashid, and other friends is important in this regard. He contributes to Salim's authorial position, which he lacked initially due to the love of his mother. Being a good Muslim in a Zia's Pakistan means being a strong man who can assert himself over his women so that he can protect them. Salim is thus entrusted with the responsibility of protecting the honor of his women. Any failure to do so would be a blow to his masculinity. While Salim spots a golden wristwatch in the market and is about to buy it for Zubeda, his longtime girlfriend, his friend snatches it away from him saying, "Where will she ever wear this watch?" The watch here stands as a metaphor for an independent working woman who can afford the luxury of wearing a wristwatch itself. Gifting her a watch would in some way still steal his power over her and would be a threat to his masculine authority. The good Muslim man is thus supposed to keep his woman within the confines of four walls. After Salim comes under the influence of jihad, he aids the other supporters in raising the school wall higher. This assertion of his masculinity itself is underlined with a tone of religion and fundamentalism. Something that makes younger men like Rashid politically influential and elder men who do not conform as naive individuals. In a particular scene at a tea stall in the village, villagers are watching Zia's speech, which according to them doesn't seem to make a point now. At this point, Rashid arrives, agreeing with his sentiment and asking that the volume to be turned up. To this, one villager says, "It's all about politics. What's it to do with us?" And another adds, "Pakistan exists, why harp about it? talk about the price of wheat instead. To this he responds by saying, men shed blood for this country and all you care about is food. You will be stuffing your face while they take our women. This scene is striking on several levels, but most pertinently, here the language of honor, death and abduction being used in case of women is derogatory. Rashid can be seen to be preaching about how men shed blood and women were taken without considering, and how these images he draws are on actual histories of people who have been a victim of partition. Instead, Rashid uses the images of men shedding blood and women being taken as a rhetorical device for a particular nationalist sentiment, which in itself celebrates masculinity in a very larger sense. Images of loss, trauma and violence are dominating the cinematic discourse of partition. They present to us dreadful repercussions of the event that are otherwise read in a limited historical and political context. These films in a covert way, however, showcase women's newfound identities and the negotiations they make in their lives, even if in a small way. Films on partition offer to us an alternative perspective to history, and through representations of female protagonists as agents rather than victims. By doing so, they underline the complexities of women's life during partition itself. There are several instances in which they appear in an unconventional way. So women appear not merely as objects of gendered violence, but also as individuals who make choices, who negotiate, fight all odds, and emerge successful in the end in their own possible ways. These are negotiations that they make with themselves and their newfound identities in their smaller or larger spheres of the society. To Laura Mulvey, in her essay, Visual Pleasures in Narrative Cinema, she introduces the idea of male gaze. Several films in partition stand at a high risk of being voyeuristic and present female characters as objects to the male gaze due to the nature of the narrative itself. Films like Train to Pakistan and 1947 Earth are examples of excellent handling of the subject without being voyeuristic in their approach. This avoids the risk of representation of women as fetishized objects to satiate the male gaze. A film like Kamosh Pani rejects the notion of erotic scopophilia by introducing the presence of a female hero embodied in Aisha's character rather than presenting a male hero agent in the form of Salim, her son. The gaze in this case is not voyeuristic, but that which locates the male subject into the complexities of the female subject and her life in these films. While the decision to geographically separate the two states was a political one, what followed was a result of extreme religious fundamentalism on both sides of the border. The battle for separate India and Pakistan became a battle of two religious identities. This meant religious antagonism, which was so strong that several people lost their lives. Although represented in subtle ways that sometimes go unnoticed in the films, female protagonists do challenge these dominating forces in several partition films. So be it Aisha, who makes the point that religion does not teach to kill, or Zubaydah, who tells Salim that she prays to God but she isn't blind, women contest this hegemony of fundamentalists in these films. This attempt by the films is an attempt to explore what Walter Benjamin calls a continuum of history. What it does is that it wrings mankind away from conformism, according to Benjamin. One such key element in this is the role of memory and transgression that leads to a woman's agency. So flashbacks and memory of the protagonist act as powerful medium of establishing the woman's position and several underpinnings of her struggle for survival. So flashback is the most significant cinematic device used in Kamosh Pani. Flashbacks present a time when Aisha's religious and national identity shift from Indian to Sikh to Pakistani and Muslim. The key narrative, although set against increasing religious nationalism, these flashes expose Aisha's traumatic history and her nation and the nation's traumatic founding in general. So basically, these flashbacks not only reveal the story to us, but they also act as powerful mediums of establishing Aisha's position as a woman and the several underpinnings of her struggle for survival. So two characters that are key elements of the film, that is Aisha's father and Aisha's husband, are revealed to the audiences only through the flashbacks. Another important aspect of this is the ideology of love, the assertion of one's love, especially in spite of all the differences that come up. So basically, love occupies a key position in all the three films. All these three women struggle in order to get their long lost love. Difference is a very common factor in both these relationships since all these three women are abducted from their original homelands. These relationships open up spaces for these women in order to understand who they are and what they want in life, and thus they actually rule these relationships on their own terms. So in conclusion, I would like to say that the idea of looking at female agency itself in partition narratives is never fully explored. It is important to see that it is not only the history itself but also the reconstruction that limit a woman's agency. So films like Khamosh Pani helps us defamiliarize ourselves from the historicity of the actual event and engages us in the fragmented narrative instead. What it does in the course of time is very significant because it challenges the age-old notions of patriarchy and suppression of women and gives them an alternative way of representation. The very idea of analyzing film representations of women in Indian films is a complex one. This is because the theoretical constructions of the female body and their on-screen presence are all products of the Western School of Film Studies. However, while this is true, films on partition are excellent examples to look at the intertwining of characters, cinematic devices, and audience reception, and also to understand the larger history that goes behind all of this. It is therefore very crucial for us to examine such an alternative reading to the same text. It must be understood that history itself is an amalgamation of multiple and overlapping accounts. Partition history of women is one such account that gets overshadowed in the narrative of trauma, thus somewhere blurring a woman's agential capacity, which we must never forget.